a lot of this work comes or is based on this original work, which was actually done way back in the 1950s by Bloom et al. And everyone talks about Bloom's taxonomy. Have you heard of Bloom's taxonomy?
Absolutely.
So Bloom gets cited all the time. I'm one of those fortunate people who was born with a surname starting in A. And Bloom always reminds me how fortunate I am. There were actually 14 people involved in the research project that was done. But Bloom was the editor, and arguably was one of several editors, and although he probably, to some extent, was leading the project, the argument is he wasn't the only person leading the project. There were several principal investigators, but it's always been Bloom's taxonomy. I'm working my way up to Atkinson's taxonomy. This was the original, so you'll see the same similar progression from basically the knowledge, if you think about this in terms of business language and pre-structural, single structural, you know, unistructural, multi-structural. We go from knowledge to comprehending that knowledge, the ability to apply that comprehension and knowledge, the ability to analyze, start to compare one's application to other applications, and then to synthesize and evaluate. That's a kind of classic image, and it's used a lot. And if you walk around American universities, there's a poster on the wall, and there's a pyramid, and it's Bloom's taxonomy, and you can recognize it from 300 yards. In 2001, Anderson and Krathwohl revised, again, an edited volume, but they revised that work. And they did a couple of quite interesting things. One, they actually drew together this notion of knowledge and comprehension, referred to it in terms of remembering and understanding. So they kind of put those two things together as fairly low-order skills, but foundational. You know, you have to know it in order to be able to do other things with it. It's fairly foundational. And the other thing they did was they actually reversed evaluate and synthesize. They actually felt that the process of synthesizing knowledge was actually a much more higher-order thinking skill in terms of cognition than purely evaluating. So again, you know, some contested notions of what these words actually mean. And they added this notion of create. So this is a representation, again, that you'll see other versions of this. This is my version, but you'll see similar versions of this on the web. Is that they brought together remember and understand as a foundational. So if you like it kind of, for argument's sake, it starts there and goes this way around. Yeah? So we remember, we apply, we analyze, we evaluate, we synthesize. So if we take the cognitive domain, what I've tried to do here with this illustration is to say, these are the activities, the teaching and learning activities, we think about BIGs, but they're also the learning outcomes. So if I have a learning outcome that says that the learner should be able to classify zoological species according to, right? That would also be the activity. You'd expect in your teaching and learning to have them classify. There wouldn't be a lot of point in having as an outcome that they have the ability to classify and then actually spend all of your time getting them to locate and identify them based on existing, right? You want them to be able to do something with that, to understand at a higher order of skill. Now, I recognize that there's ambiguity about the individual words. You have to count the times I use the word ambiguous. Because we've just agreed amongst ourselves that the words don't fit neatly into columns. But there's the sense in which one is progressing around this circle. The second thing is, what I've added around the outside, from quite a few of the formulations of this you'll see, is that the product of these activities, the evidence produced as a result of doing these teaching and learning activities, also is the assessment form. So you may not actually be being asked to write assessment. That may be that that's prescribed and that there are, you know, agreements made by module leaders and within the schools. But nonetheless, this is the evidence that would be produced in order to demonstrate one's ability. Okay? I recognise it's quite small. Hopefully you do have a printout of this, which I did in grayscale, so it should be readable. Not that one, the next page. You've got a large one as well. And as I say, I'm happy to let you have these. I just didn't want to print out lots of coloured. I mean, it looks fantastic, but you know, printing it all out on a colour printer seems a bit excessive. And as a generous as Apollo are, I think we must still have a budget somewhere. No one's telling me what it is yet, but there must be one. So what you have is a sense in which there's a progression with all the contested nature of those words, where you're looking to say, well, what kind of evidence is actually being produced to fulfill that learning outcome and activity in order to represent that particular level of higher order thinking skill? Okay. Now, that's not to say that you can't actually have students produce a graph that they've actually constructed in order to demonstrate that actually they have remembered some of the basic elements of knowledge. It doesn't mean you can't do that. This is just an attempt. I use this when I work with staff writing learning outcomes to say to them, you know, here's a clue about the different order of things. And if you want to move something forward or backwards, then that's actually fine. But I would argue that there is a difference, potentially, from actually, you know, writing an article for a predefined journal. You could write an article and say, this should be of an ability to actually be published in an academic journal. Or you could say, write something as though it's in a school magazine. Right. So yeah, clearly that could actually appear here. And in some ways it does. You know, we've got magazines and newspapers. You know, so it's just simply a provocation. What I have started doing is adding some of the things like that are more, if you like, Web 2 or that are more contemporary. So the introduction of something like VoiceThread as a technology, as a piece of evidence that might be produced for assessment purposes, and so on. But this is a sort of another way of looking at the verb structures and trying to think about what the consequences of them might be.
But very artistic.
Thank you. Yes, a frustrated artist. What's interesting is, this is what I wanted you to think about a little bit, is this particular illustration is for the cognitive domain. So Bloom's taxonomy refers almost exclusively, or Bloom actually didn't in the original work exclusively refer to the cognitive domain, but that's the one that in a sense has taken the world by storm. So we deal primarily with that, the pyramid and this representation. So this is the cognitive domain, and you recognize it from the pyramid, remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and synthesize. And there's a huge stress, because most academics can get their head around that, so there's a huge stress on that notion of cognition. It gets a little bit more complicated, because within the QAA, there is also a sense that there are these other skills, which if you reread the benchmark statements and you reread the level descriptors in a moment, you'll see that there is an indication of other things. There are transferable skills, and there's the notion of values as well. So we have professional skills, practical skills, as well as intellectual skills. So it's not uncommon to see in program specifications in higher education establishments that that's actually broken down. And you'll see that they'll say, and I do this certainly in my practice, that I would say, I would write learning outcomes as being intellectual, professional practice, and transferable. And then at the top, there's something which is usually called knowledge and understanding. So often that's simply a specification of the domain. So we say, you know, law. So, you know, we want them to basically come to terms with the structure and shape of English law. This is the point at which they're going to start doing something. That level becomes a significant factor. But I've also got other things. This might be ethics in law. The professional skill could be argumentation. It could be, you know, some other professional skill, which is not in itself necessarily an intellectual skill. You can actually define almost everything in terms of cognition if you choose to. You stretch the words to mean those things. But there are actually two other domains. And I realise that this isn't a master's class in educational theory, but it's interesting, I think, for you to be aware of this. And I would like you, as instructional designers, to be aware of it. Which is that the other two domains, some of which was based on work, again, from the early 1960s, is referred to as the affective domain. These are personal value systems. So this relates quite closely, in fact, to some of these professional practice skills, what it means to be a professional in that particular discipline, beyond one's intellectual cognition. And we go through the same, they start in the same place. So at a very basic level, to just receive, in a sense, instruction, information, process, to be instructed on timekeeping is a fairly low-level order of affective skills. But if you move that round, at the ultimate level, what you've done is you've internalized those values at quite a high level. So your ability to influence as a professional other people in your profession is quite a high order affective skill. And you go through in a similar pattern. Okay? And the third domain, which actually received very little attention in the 60s but was picked up in the early 70s, is the psychomotor domain. And it's sort of unfortunately named because I've had a conversation once with someone who insisted on telling me that this just meant it was a bit like, you know, could they lay bricks, and it was about being a bricklayer and had no relevance at all to biology undergraduates. And I was saying, well, no, actually, we're not just talking about, you know, the very simple level of physical and motor skills. We might be talking about a geography student who masters the ability to use a GIS system. Or it could be that there's a particular business skill, financial skill, that means being able to actually manipulate a piece of financial software. That would be seen as a manual skill. Yes, of course, there's intellectual processes involved in that, but so is there in laying bricks in a wall and getting it right. So there are kind of practical, if you think of them as very practical physical skills, that in university terms might be working with particular bits of software, with particular specialist bits of a kit in a chemistry lab or whatever. Those, and to develop those skills, there is a difference between just doing what someone else does and shows you, and being able to manipulate it so that it actually can do something slightly different, and becoming incredibly precise about that, and really refining your skills so that you do it in a very, very precise way. The ability to actually express it to other people, the ability to actually make it work in other ways and new domains and extend it. And then again, taking it so that it just becomes completely natural for you to actually do it in that particular way. So it's a kind of a structure that becomes progressively complex.
So, can I just ask, whereabouts would you say that working in groups primarily lies in the context of this?
That's a really interesting question. I tend to think, I don't think it's a cognitive, and that's a good example because everyone talks about the cognitive domain. And then we've got this thing that says the ability to work together. Mm. And I don't see the ability to work together as a question of cognition. I see it actually as it's an effective skill. And so actually then you find that when you're writing activities that are around things like group work, you want to mesh somehow the two things together. So yes, there's some intellectual process going on. Mm. What would be appropriate at the same level? So if I realize that this can make you feel poorly, I'm going to flip back and forth, right? So let's say, for example, that what you want the students to do as a learning outcome is you want them, within the notion of being able to analyze, you might have a learning outcome that says the ability to compare and contrast, they sit within the same, so that's not too ambiguous, that compare and contrast different approaches to rural poverty. Okay? And what you want them to produce as a result is a report, as though to a ministry. So you say, please write a 5,000-word report summary looking at a couple of different approaches advocated by different social policy groups to rural poverty. But I want you to do it together. You think, that's a great opportunity for people to work together in teams. So I look at my equivalent in terms of level and say, how do I get them to do these kinds of skills? Are these the kinds of skills that working together at that level is appropriate? So might I want, in a sense, people to demonstrate that they have different views? Might I want someone to actually, I want them to debate in order to produce that? So how I would specify that task to the group would then start to take on board some of these skills. To simply say, group work, you know, I mean, I could go shopping with five people, but you know, that doesn't necessarily demonstrate much in the way of group work. However, if you actually give me a specified budget and say, I want you to actually negotiate in order to do this, this, and this, then it might start challenging some of my numerical skills, and I might need to be able to justify decisions and argument and influence. And so a task, you know, loosely defined is just a task. Whereas if you start to define how you want someone to go about it and why, and you link it then to the other levels of domain, you get into some quite interesting combinations. Mm. But you would have to structure the assignment to make that visible. So if you genuinely wanted to have individuals in a group, if I split you into groups of, say, three and four, and I said, I want you to actually go through a process of refuting, picking a number of different policy positions, I want you to find some refutation for one of them, and then I want you to come to a consensus in order to actually justify your choice. That's what I'm going to ask you to do, and I want you to document that process. And what you're doing in doing that is actually producing a report based on comparing and contrasting two. So one's cognitive, one's affective. And I can take it one step further if I wanted to and say, what skills, in terms of psychomotor skills, am I actually engaging? Well, actually, I'm probably getting them to be, you need to be fairly precise about that. It's a fairly complex task. Does it actually require some things? Are you actually drawing, writing at some level? Does it require some of these? Are you having to formulate new approaches? Like, where does it fit? There's nothing to say that you don't actually have a cognitive task that you sort of define as being at level 5 that actually requires sort of less in the way of effective skills or more. You know, if you in law, for instance, you might actually need to stress quite heavily some of those value skills. And in one module, it might be that actually the cognitive skills are less important than their ability to actually develop those effective skills. So you might give them a fairly simple task in intellectual terms, but give them quite a complex task in terms of negotiation and differentiation and so on. So, I mean, I don't know how useful other people find this representation. Clearly they're colourful. I hope they're artistic. I worked with some staff in Massey. This is stuff that I'm working and writing about at the moment. And for me, having those three alongside each other are quite interesting. But I'm going to ask you the same question I asked you when I showed you the Biggs illustration in pairs and three. Where do you think level maps onto those particular pieces of the pie? Again, language here is quite interesting because... Amanda and I had this conversation the other day about outcomes and objectives. From my perspective, it's a lot easier if we only talk about outcomes as being program outcomes and module outcomes.
It's lucky.
Right? So they're the big stuff, right? So you have program outcomes. In theory, all of those are made up of intended learning outcomes at the modular level. And they're outcomes. Because those are the things that you're going to assess. Right? You aren't necessarily assessing what happens at topic level. You might be, but you're not necessarily going to assess them. So from my perspective, it's a lot more sensible to think about topics as being objectives, not being outcomes. So personally, and I mean, I don't know whether we'll rewrite the language or not, maybe, but I would say you don't need topic outcomes in the same, quite the same sense. Now, at the moment, I think you work with these as topic outcomes. Yeah. But in a sense, we think of them as objectives. Mm-hmm. It means that this week, the intention is that I, right?
Yeah.
But it may not be something that you assess or demonstrate.
Right.
It might be something you just do.
The objectives?
The objectives.
Right.
So, call it...
The outcomes you assess.
If you want to call it an outcome, fine. But I think it's useful in a sense, certainly for students, it's a lot clearer to think of outcomes as the thing that they're assessed against.
An outcome an outcome kind of implies it will definitely happen.
Well, it was an objective. It is designed that students will be able to do this. Provided they do their work, yeah.
But the point that I was making, yes, I was making the point that it's entirely possible that what you're actually doing at the beginning of your 8-week we're looking at 8-week modules, 8-week modules or 15-week modules or however long the module is, that what you do in the initial part of that module might actually be at a much lower level. So you might actually, in the first part of your module, in weeks 2, 3, and 4, whether you call them outcomes or objectives, but it might be that what you're doing is recording on the basis of what you know, recording that, bringing it together, yeah, producing a list.
But that makes total sense.
Okay. And then halfway through the course, because this is possibly a postgraduate course, halfway through the course, you might start then categorizing that list as part of the activities that you do. Because ultimately, what your objective says is that you should be able to debate and evaluate different positions. So, as you were saying earlier, you can't necessarily do that if you haven't already done that and done that. I think there is a concern to make sure that one is achieving those outcomes, but I think there's also a need for us to be quite clever about how we get students to that. So certainly what we don't want them to do is to spend 10 weeks doing low-level stuff. But a process of working backwards that says, well, actually the outcome the learning outcome that I'm assessing is their ability to make some editorial decisions. Okay. Then in order to do that, they're going to have to be able to work through and separate out arguments, or you know, so we work backwards. And you get to that intended learning outcome as quickly as you can, but you do need to build on foundational knowledge.
Yeah.
Where you don't have to, and this is where this becomes important, is that within the program, I would know, this might be my level 6, but I would know that actually there were prerequisite modules at level 5 that actually had already covered some of those things. So if I know that actually I'm writing this module, but actually the level 5 module that they all have to have done actually have done an awful lot of them developing lists and synthesizing that basic knowledge, and they already have the content knowledge to go with it, I then don't have to bother with that. I might spend week 2 just reminding them they've done it, and then I'd go straight in week 3 and get them up to these higher order thinking skills. Very, very roughly, people talk in terms of these being roughly, right? 30, 20. So if you think about it like this, then it's not actually, you know, you start writing learning outcomes would be, there'd be two learning outcomes in that cognitive domain, two learning outcomes in that affective domain. Sorry, three intellectual, so three cognitive, three professional, two here. And the knowledge ones are in a sense non-domain. I mean, they're not, you know, they can be written in terms of simply the subject area that needs to be covered. They define the subject area. Students will have, it's okay at that level to write, students will have a knowledge and understanding of the body of literature around, blah, 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 blah. But they just need to be aware of that. But generally at this level, you wouldn't write an outcome which was knowledge and understanding, because it's difficult to assess knowledge and understanding. You can only assess someone's ability to do something. And they don't do knowledge and understanding, they have to demonstrate it. So then you get into the whole question of, you know, the way you write your learning outcomes has to have some accessible, demonstrable verb associated with it. And then you can start looking at those. But you can argue, they're contestable. I mean, just as everything else is, you know, it's like I present those and use those because I find them really helpful when I'm designing and when I'm helping other people to design. But then we argue about the same thing about progression and have I actually got, you know, have I done what I need to have done in order to do what I want to do next? So my question was about level. What do you think? Where do you think this maps onto levels 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8? Or indeed, level 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Any thoughts?
I think, again, we were saying before, it's kind of the circular version of doing that linear one we looked at before. So with remembering, understanding, you're talking about, again, going from there, 3, 4, working through the 7. But, again, we've still got the blurred areas. There are blurred lines between those sectors, and indeed the use of the tools in the outer section.
Everyone agree with that? And there's no contact, no one thinks that there's a firm fit?
No.
Definitely can't encourage you to consider a firm fit?
No.
Sure, absolutely sure.
Absolutely.
And the answer is no.
Wish you could. Easier for us, then.
Absolutely. And I think that, but one of the reasons why I think it's quite useful to get to the point where you say, actually, it's not that clear, it is ambiguous, there are, you know, fuzzy areas, is so that when somebody gives you a list of verbs, you have to say, well, great, I've got a list of verbs, but actually those verbs do apply to the level above and to the level below, depending on context, depending on where they fit into the learning equation, depending on what part of the learning journey they're part of, you know, and depending on how they're going to be assessed and what evidence, or what level. You know, it's all very well to identify, but I can identify at level 4 and I can identify at level 8. Mm. You know, those are very different, those are potentially very different things, depending on context. And so then we get into context.